confirm the death of the suspected illegal miner and what happened exactly.
Thank you very much. I must say that again, let me send our most sincere sympathies, condolence to the deceased family. We are told one Ajumai, who is of 31 years, was a hobby, a suspected illegal miner who lost his life. The fact of the case, as I have it,
arrested 80 people so far, we are told. Yes?
Yes, I will more than be happy to talk about our activities so far. Because since we started this operation in Eastern Region and Western Region, a lot of factors have been chosen. This force has stood in Eastern and Western Region. Together, we have arrested as many as 82 suspected illegal mines. And as I speak, some have already been sent to the court. Some are in prison remand. Others are waiting while the evidence has been processed so that they can be placed the right institution, that is the competent court, which will try them to determine whether they are guilty or not. And then we said that throughout this region, we haven't had any resistance. We haven't had any resistance for anybody. We haven't even moved a finger to anybody.
Okay.
Because we know that this country is the regulation. We don't know why a country region has become a different ballgame. I don't know if it has anything to do with the threat
that they issued earlier. All right. We would have to leave it here for now, but thank you for making time to speak with us, Colonel William Ejapong. He's the commander of the Operation Vanguard, that joint military and police team that have been deployed, the task force that has been deployed to ensure that Galamsey is dealt with decisively and brought to a conclusive end. We will do well to speak to one of the members of the Small Scale Miners Association in the Ashanti region. They are saying that the man that was shot was not exchanging gunshots with the police and the soldiers as well. There was no exchange, so they are surprised it has happened so. But as you can tell, the commander also confirmed to us that, yes, there was pelting of stones, and they heard gunshots. So they fired warning shots to disperse them, and it was based on the back of that. There is a suspicion that one of the suspected illegal miners was shot. As to how a warning shot went to hit someone is a bone of contention now. But hopefully, in the coming days, we'll be able to get some clarity on this particular story. This is still Midday Live on TV3. Trust us. We'll keep an eye on it and keep you posted as and when new angles do emerge. Let's go to the seat of government now, because President Akufo-Addo has begun a three-day tour of the Western region today. We know that the president, as part of the trip, will pay a courtesy call on the chiefs and people of the northern part of the region to reiterate his commitment of creating the proposed Western North region out of the current Western region. His meeting with chiefs will include stops at a derba of chiefs and people of Bidieni and a courtesy call on the Omanhene and elders of Yoso traditional area. The tour will also include a brief stop at Denchobwase, the town that captured public attention for being the following the gruesome murder of Major Mahama, the army officer. The chiefs and people, ahead of the president's arrival, are demanding a decision to be made on the fate of the district chief executive of the Upper Dinka West District, who was also arrested. He was suspended. The president is also scheduled to visit some Galamsey sites to monitor the progress of work by the anti-Galamsey task force recently deployed on Operation Vanguard. So the images on your screens are actually pictures coming in live from the president's arrival at the Western region, where the chiefs and people were waiting for him because he's on a three-day tour of the Western and Central region. So we want to speak to our correspondent now. William Benjamin Peters handles the Western region for TV3. He's joined us. William, good afternoon and thank you for joining us.
Yeah, good afternoon, Martin.
Where specifically is the president now, and has he said anything so far?
Yeah, the president is in the TV, and it is the paramount chief of TV, and he has a traditional area, who is currently delivering his speech. But the president is here in the region for a three-day tour. He will be visiting several places, including TV, also Denchobwase, Tafa, and Sa. just to set up a nursing training college here at Bidiani Angra, which is one of the major problems confronting the constraints. So that has already been accomplished. The CEO of Coco Board, Joseph White, did also address the gathering, and he also told them that they came to inherit a lot of debt from Coco Board, but by now, President have already put in place so lot that he has been able to settle that debt by June, and as a result, he is also doing a lot to improve the cocoa sector with the introduction of the mass training exercise, which will be launched today at CV. So currently, it is the paramount chief of CV and Yasu Traditional Area, Ojiawoho Yaudi, the second, who is also the president of the Western Regional House of Chiefs, who is delivering a speech. We are hoping that afterwards, the president will also deliver a speech.
Okay, my last question is that the president, we are told, will be heading to Benchoboase, that infamous town where Captain Mahama, now Major Mahama, was killed. What are the expectations ahead of the president's arrival?
Yeah, you know, the tragic news that the whole world, which led to the demise of the late Major Mahama, came as a shocking news to the entire world. You know, the president is here to visit the town, so he's taking this opportunity in the region to make a stopover at Dinchobati. You know, Dinchobati is in the central region,
right,
but it's along the route to Sekiyoso. So definitely, I believe he will visit the site where the unfortunate incident happened. And we anxiously are waiting for the president's visit to the place and the message, the kind of message that he will give to the people of Dinchobati.
Thank you very much for that comprehensive report. William Benjamin Peters is TV3's Western Regional Correspondent with an update on the president's three-day tour. Trust us, we'll keep an eye on it and keep you posted. Wherever the president goes, TV3 News will be there. Let's go up to the northern part of the country now. One out of the four victims of Saturday, August 4th rainstorm in the East Gonja district of the northern region has been discharged. The victim revealed she only woke up Sunday, August 5th, to find herself in a hospital.
All I can remember is that it rained heavily yesterday and my room fell on me. I woke up today on a hospital bed. I have been discharged. The DCE came today to check on us and has asked the hospital authorities to get him the bills of myself and the other victims for him to pay for us.
The three other victims are still on admission with two at a private clinic also in the district. Four persons were reported injured in Salaga in the East Gonja district of the northern region following heavy rains there. Although no relief items have reached the victims, the East Gonja DCE revealed the assembly will bear the cost of medication. The rains, according to some residents, began about 11:30 Saturday morning, flooding the entire Salaga township. Shops situated on the edges of drains were also flooded, destroying property running into thousands of cedis. The four, two of whom suffered head and neck injuries, were caught up in the floods during the downpour, which swept through the district Saturday, August 4, 2017.
We only have to get the assembly, all stakeholders, government, to see how we can work on the drains in town. Because the problem is that most of the drains are choked, and that is causing this situation. It's unfortunate, and we will see how we can work on it.
Some residents, including the East Gonja District Chief Executive, Mohamed Tanimo, have blamed the floods on choked gutters. He's unable to tell how many homes have been affected at the time of filing this report, but believes a chunk of homes have been affected.
So let's swing away from that part of the country to another part, because we are covering the entire country. For your decision to welcome a Canadian professor into their community has changed the fortunes of the Bamate in the Akachi district of the Volta region. Robert Abelba reports the community received some amenities, several of them from philanthropists.
This story dates back 27 years ago, when Professor Kathy Armstrong, a Canadian scholar, visited Dagbamate to learn traditional drumming, dancing, and singing. She was mentored by Professor Frederick Kwesi Dunyo, a master drummer. Professor Kathy Armstrong returned to Dagbamate, and with support from York University in Canada to build teachers' bungalows and an ICT center. Other projects included the improvement of the Afetoku traditional shrine, a clinic and accommodation facility for nurses, as well as one-story bungalow for the medical officer. A six-unit one-story classroom block and a two-story guest house are nearing completion. The Canadian partner's intervention, the people recalled, is accelerating the development of Dabamati, hence a derby in honor of the benefactors. Professor Cathy Armstrong was delighted over the achievement.
This is no one-way relationship, though. The key to the success and sustainability of our work is the reciprocity of the benefit. Visitors to Dabamate always receive a warm welcome, are granted full access to cultural traditions.
Professor Frederick Christy Dunio, whose efforts clinched the deal with the Canadians, appealed to the affluent in society to lean towards the needy and the vulnerable.
You don't have to be a politician to help your community or your country. You have to think of a human life, a human being. It's more important than money. If you have a chance of getting something, think of the poor ones, those who needed it most. And the little help you can give them, please do it.
The Deba celebrated the gains made 27 years ago.
Thank you. upon who is an industrial and an occupational health psychologist here in the studio to give us more detail into that research being conducted. Hello, sir. Thank you for your time and thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Now, can you give us a full detail of what exactly your research is talking about?
Okay. The full detail will be too much.
Brief.
Yes.
As in
basically,
brief.
I was trying to look at the comprehension of road hazard communication designs or road warning signs and what we call safety climate as how that affects risk perception and risk taking behavior. So,
really, what is the essence of this whole research? Because you would agree with me that Parliament has already passed it, even though the debate is still going. What triggered this research?
Okay. Now, this research was done in 2016, and I did not do it just because it was chosen. In fact, that was not really part of it, but the findings seem to speak to the root, the nationwide tolling issue that we are trying to address in the country. That is why it's important for us to discuss the findings of this research.
And where did you get your data? How did you collect it? And what really was the outcome?
Okay. I collected the data from commercial vehicle drivers, Tudus, Medina, and then Circle Newfoundland. Basically, that's where I got my data.
What was the outcome? What findings did you get?
Okay, now let me be more specific. The findings I'm going to talk about is just about the accident frequency.
Okay.
Because the other aspect of the research. But in terms of the accident frequency, what I found was that if I look at the various accidents that the drivers reported, then accident or collision with vehicle left on the road constituted about 2% of all the accidents, about 451 accidents.
Which is contrary to what has already come out, I'm sure.
Exactly.
Yes.
Exactly.
But apart from that, now this research has come out, and it looks like it's quite different from what the Road Safety Commission has come out with.
Mm-hmm.
Where have you taken this research to, and what are you hoping to achieve with it?
Okay. Now, in terms of where I've taken the research to, coming here is one way of doing that, or getting it or the findings communicated to the whole world or to the Ghanaian public to understand what is happening in terms of what our research has found. And then, in terms of what I hope to see happening, I'm thinking that the Parliament will consider the airline. Probably amendments could do. After all, the laws were made by human beings, so human beings can amend if they have to. But let me also be more specific in terms of whether the tolling is needed or is not needed. Now, let's understand that to ensure that there is safety on our roads, we need to look at the human element, we need to look at the vehicle, we need to look at the road and emergency infrastructure. Now, tolling service, the National Ambulance Authority and the service they provide, the fire service, they all constitute part of the emergency service provided.
I'm still not a bit clear on exactly why this research has been conducted. Exactly what do you hope to achieve with this? Because already, fine, the debate is ongoing. Your research has come out.
Mm-hmm.
What difference are you expecting to create, even though you're calling on Parliament to change the airline, if that is possible?
If they can, yes. Now, let me say this, that the study was not done in response to any towing levy. That's the first thing you need to understand. But when the issue came up, by looking at the data, I realized that the findings on the accident frequency speak to the issues being discussed, particularly where there was an impression being created that accident with vehicle left on the road constitutes a major part of the accident.
So are you concluding that the towing levy should be abandoned, even though Parliament, should it be reversed with the decision taken by Parliament?
Now,
from your research you've come out with right now.
Now, that is where I want to say something in relation to that. Towing itself is something that needs to be done.
Fine.
It needs to be done.
Right.
But the question maybe you need to address is, should it be compulsory and fee being charged? That is the question you need to be asked.
So that is your question. I'm sure we will have more time with you to go more further into that research you've conducted. But Seth Opong, industrial and occupational health psychologist, is questioning whether the towing levy should be compulsory or the show.
allocated for the annual budget funding amount for agriculture modernization, road and other infrastructure. At a public forum organized by Public Interest and Accountability Committee for residents of Asiedu-Dartey Municipality and the Ashanti Akim North District in the Ashanti region, participants complained about how the petroleum revenue has been managed.
But a year is not to go round everywhere. But this look at the chairman here enough and sana is one among.
A member of the committee, Dr. Kwabna Nyaku Otu, said the concerns raised by participants are justifiable because of the low level of information flow.
The fact that you have made allocations for things to be done in their district, but they don't see anything. They are not involved. So it's not possible for them to even track what the oil is doing for them. So basically, these are basic, valid concerns.
Most of the decisions regarding project selection and supervision are made in Accra. And the local governance structures, and even sometimes the regional administration are not involved in any way in terms of the selection and even the supervision of the projects. This, for me, partly accounts for the situation where some of the projects have been found to be non-existent.
Meanwhile, a joint team from the committee and the Institute of Financial and Economic Journalists tasked some project sites in the Ashanti region funded partly with the oil revenue.
Well, I saw there's more business news on